Well, all right. Happy Halloween, Danielle. Welcome to possibly the final stream of Beacon Pines. I am not entirely sure, but I know that it made me cry on stream last time, so perfect for Halloween. 'Cause what's scarier than emotional vulnerability? All right. People get these pop things to stay up. Well, regardless, there is loads to explain, so please ask questions. If we end up finishing this quite early, I do have the next mystery box, but for now, I want to just hop in and enjoy whatever else this game has to offer because it's managed to shock me quite a bit so far. Right. Meow. I usually go quite elaborate in terms of my Halloween costumes, but this year it just wasn't that possible. So I remember that I have cat ears for my headphones, and I put them on. That's about it. I have slightly forgotten. Okay, we're meant to get help, but why are we trying to get help? I have to see where we are. Okay, so we did that. Where even are we? No. That's true. I did do makeup, and my cat eye actually managed to almost sort of kind of be straighter. I suppose. I don't remember where we are. Well, I guess we'll figure it out as we go through, eh? I can give you the overall what we know about this town so far. It's pretty creepy. Pretty cool though. But right now we gotta recruit people for help. It's really hard to remember what the quests are because, as far as I am aware, there is no way for me to view them. Like, they pop up in those cute little notes, but then you can't really look at them until it's done and then it checks it off. Oh well. How's our foreshadower? Undaunted, he shook his head. Over? No. Endings are merely a state of mind. This doesn't end until I give up. Wow. I admire the conviction, but can he really pull through? I don't know, we've done a lot of different versions of this. Okay, if I wanted to find bullies, where would they be? Hey bud, have you seen anyone? No. Oh. Celebration of excellence. We all know Beacon Pines is a great town. What you might not know is great towns grow from mighty roots. And that is why you cannot tell the story of Beacon Pines without telling the story of one Sharper Valentine. Young Sharper's keen intellect and strong moral fiber led to a grand vision. A vision of community dedicated to a better tomorrow. In his own words, a better tomorrow is within our grasp, but it requires a singular mind to harness it. Lucky for all of us, he decided to grow that vision here in Beacon Pines. And how does one grow a better tomorrow? With fertilizer, of course. Valentine's Fertilizer Company became the lifeblood of a town yearning for purpose. But then, tragedy struck. A scientific experiment gone wrong. An accident which took Sharper away from us far too soon. To this day, we struggle to pick up the pieces. But one foul harvest isn't enough to stop the people of Beacon Pines. The spirit of Sharper Valentine lives on. Lives in the hearts of everyone with a dream for a better tomorrow. Together, we will follow his example and grow a bountiful future. Paid for by the Valentine family and the Valentine Fertilizer Company Remembrance Fund. Oh, I kind of remember. Okay, so. Oh, do you want to know what happened yesterday? Because I can tell you what that means. This game took some turns. It took some turns. But what's happening now is we're almost at the beginning of the story, so... No, he is in the body of a small child dog that he is going to then make grown up. Which he does. There's also... This Beacon Pines is not the Beacon Pines the characters know. When they renovated the town and everyone went to hotels, they actually just moved the entire town. Because the regular town, which apparently no one noticed, is completely frozen over by this, they call it the source, but it's like a, some type of material that lets you control time, kind of, but also causes a cryogenic winter. So we've frozen the town many times in our attempt to save it. And in this particular iteration, I did just remember, Rollo, our friend, was kidnapped. We found him at the treehouse, except now he's an adult. Honestly, probably. These people didn't notice. And then Beck came and told us that she was listening on the radio and picked up some of the signals from the company where basically they said they were going to keep her mom hostage until she finished whatever work she was sent to do. And then, you know, tie up the loose ends. So she's either going to leave the company, I believe they said, like, completely devoted to it, or she's just, you know, gonna leave in a body bag. So, we're recruiting help. We've also gone through interrogations. We've gone through, friend fights. We've gone through sacrifice of a child. That's what made me cry. You ever wondered why an agricultural company employs an army of survey takers? The clipboards? They say they're just trying to make us happy. Do they want to make us happy? Or just figure out what makes us happy? An important distinction. She is correct. Good job, Dawn. Ma? Hey, Jeff.
What can I do you for?
Well, I know how much you hate perennial harvest.
Hate's a strong word.
Oh, sorry, I mean...
I didn't say it was the wrong word.
Gotcha. So we're gonna break into their headquarters, and I thought you might be able to help. Oh yes, we're heisting. This is the heisting part. Jeff wheezed out a long snicker.
Hee! See, I knew you kids were alright.
Oh dear. Great, so you'll help? The joy in Jeff's face drained instantly.
Not a chance.
But...
Give me one good reason I should risk my hide aiding and abetting you rascals.
Sometimes strong words are called for. Looking into the sullen eyes of his would-be accomplice, Luca blurted out the first word that came to mind.
Fight! Hide! Junk! Shit!
Oh no, this is too many options. When in doubt, go with shit.
Shit!
Yeah, it's all shit. Still ain't helping. Ain't that some shit.
Hee hee! Can I just do that one again? No. Okay, so it looks like you can only go back and change things if you end up ending the story. Oh, okay, cool. Fight.
Done enough fighting for one lifetime and more than my share of losing. Time's come to hang up the gloves.
Junk.
Yeah, what of it? Sonny, I've got more junk than a king-ass copper. Ain't interested.
Hide. Jeff's brow perked up.
What'd you say?
Go ahead and hide then. Sensing some traction, Luca carried on with vigor. Let a bunch of kids do what needs to be done. We're not afraid. Jeff's skull. Faded with a sigh.
Say what you will about old Jeff, and they all do, but you'll never hear him say I hid from nothing.
One good stomp of the foot was all Jeff needed to drive his point home.
What was it you kids needed?
Some sort of disguise.
I've got just the thing.
And while we're at it, that crate should come in handy.
This ain't gonna be free, you know. I'm thinking 5 bags of sour gob should cover it.
Put it on my tab. Luca offered out his open hand to seal the deal. With a firm and dusty grip, Jeff reciprocated. Done. Swing by first thing in the morning. Alright, that's one down. Hello, terrifying penguin child. Will you help me? No. I think one of my favorite things we learned is that this man, Mr. Nuncreed, is obviously helping the bad guys. I think we figured that out in the first stream, but Nuncreed's drugstore is an anagram of underground secrets, and that is the password to get into the underground tunnels. So the villains are real smart. Aha! Iggy, you're not dead! Hey, Tish, look who it is! Luca, are you here to try to tickle us to death again? Look, just hear me out. Iggy raised an eyebrow suspiciously. We're listening. Iggy, I know we've both been giant bags of shit to each other. Iggy gave a reluctant shrug. You're not wrong. But lately, life has been kinda strange, you know? Iggy considered the point. Things have been weird around here. So I'm offering a truce and asking for your help. What do you say we break some shit? Break our hostilities, at least for now. We do like breaking things. This child is armed to the gills with explosives, or at least he was at one point. What if I told you there was a way to have a truce and break stuff? Go on. I need you to cause a distraction so I can sneak into Perennial Harvest HQ. A wild-eyed grin spread across Iggy's face. My, my, Luca Van Horn, I'm impressed. And after this is all done, maybe you and Tish can come and hang out at the treehouse sometime. Iggy glanced over to Tish, who nodded in agreement. Fine. But not because we want to see your crappy treehouse. We just like to cause chaos. With a quick nod, Luca was off. Did you hear that, Tish? Iggy gazed up at Tish with a smile. He invited us to hang out at the treehouse. Oh my god, I'm gonna cry again. Single tear ran down Tish's cheek.
I never expected this day to come. How wonderful.
Oh, these poor children! Chapter 7, Into the Hive. A good heist requires preparation, and thorough preparation takes time. Something they had precious little of. So far, everything was in order. Jeff, Iggy, and Tish all agreed to do their part. Beck radioed Luca that night with a simple and covert message. We're locked and loaded on my end. And Rollo, after a lengthy confession, managed to persuade Roxy and Fitz to help. He stowed away in mission control for the night to avoid attracting attention of the fact that he is now a grown man. Or grown... What animal is he? Rollo, being uniquely suited for the role, would be the first to breach Perennial Harvest. The outfit provided by Jeff wasn't perfect, but a convincing disguise is 10% wardrobe, 90% confidence. Rollo took a few vigorous breaths and shook out his arms. Stay calm, Rollo. You can do this.
Got your delivery here.
A delivery? I don't have anything in my notes about a delivery. One moment. I'm so sorry, but there's no delivery scheduled for this morning.
Right. He had to think quick. That's because this goes directly to the founder. He asked that it be kept secret.
Rollo sighed, adjusting his tool belt.
You know how the founder can be. At this point, the kids do not know who the founder is, although it is, in fact, the founder of the town, Sharper Valentine, who is in the body of a child. Being raised by his daughter, whose name is Eris, but she also doesn't know that she is raising her father. It's really weird.
I suppose we can leave this one off the records.
Our harvest awaits and such.
With a stroke of his mustache, Rollo proceeded into the Perennial Harvest headquarters. I forgot to look up what language this was originally in, or if they just have lots of grammar and spelling mistakes. Our harvest awaits.
Package here for the founder.
Oh, I didn't hear anything about...
Yeah, this is a need-to-know kind of thing.
I'll just check. He stammered and flipped through the pages of his clipboard.
This goes directly to the founder. I don't have time to fill you in.
Oh, I see. If you could just complete this form...
Rollo interrupted with urgency in his voice. Every time with the forms! Look, if you want to explain to the founder why I'm late... Well, it's your funeral.
I'm sorry. What did you say your name was again?
I'm... Rollo panicked. Our harvest awaits.
Sir? That's a restricted area. Excuse me, sir.
Our harvest awaits.
Ready to light the candle, Tish?
Yep.
Suck on this perennial ham fist. What was that?
The distraction was enough for Rollo to regain his confidence.
Just open the damn door. I've got a job to do.
The clipboard fumbled around in a frenzy. I should check on that noise.
Oh, come on! Just buzz me in already!
Okay.
Okay, so they are not complete robot clones. They can be flustered.
Ugh, that was close.
Our harvest awaits.
Hey, I figure when in doubt, stick with the classics.
Well, that was a close one. But you pulled it off. Nice work, Rollo. Alright, everyone knows what to do?
Yep, deep engineering's to the north.
I'll go with Beck. In case she needs some muscle.
I'll head east to the founder's office. You two be safe.
I wonder what's in the water cooler.
That's odd. There's not even any cups for the water.
See? Maybe they are robots. Well, if they said the office was to the east, do they mean, like, keep going directly east?
Found him!
Solomon? Solomon stopped in his tracks. Shit. Luca? What are you doing here?
It's a long story. Are you okay?
A veneer of confusion flashed across Solomon's face. His words rushed out dramatically.
No, I am most certainly not okay. Some strange people grabbed me and...
Were they in hazmat suits?
Yes, how did you know? They brought me here and locked me up, and when they were distracted, I ran.
Dang. Okay, you should stick with me. We've got a plan.
Solomon's facade briefly faltered.
We?
Yeah, Rollo and Beck are headed to deep engineering. God damn it.
Thank heavens you found me. We've got to get out of here.
We can't leave just yet.
But they'll catch us again. Gotta do something first.
When you were running, did you happen to see a door marked Founder?
Founder? Why are you looking for him?
I'm not. I just need to get into that office.
Now that you mention it, I do think I saw a door that said Founder.
It was just down this way.
Luca happened to notice a plaque above the door. Office of the Founder. Knocking comes with consequence.
Oh, here it is.
So it is.
It's pretty lucky that I ran into you, or else I might have missed it.
Truly fortunate.
Luca tried the handle.
Locked. Solomon leaned forward to examine the mechanism. Regrettably, it seems to be some sort of electric lock. I don't see how we could possibly defeat a lock like that. Luca smiled and looked at his watch.
Let's just wait a minute.
Yes!
Go save your wife, girlie.
I don't know what sort of funny business you're up to, but I like it.
She mimed a quick hat tip and ambled off with a whistle. Howdy. Good afternoon.
The light on the keypad changed from red to green.
How did you do that?
It's good to have friends. Quick, let's get inside before someone spots us. Did he deface his picture of his kid? Lucas switched on his walkie-talkie. Rollo, I'm in. As expected, there's a control panel.
Great timing. We're stuck at a door marked 24601. Need you to get us through.
This was a lot cooler when you couldn't see my face, and I was doing the sound effects. What if someone catches us? We should get out of here. I'm not leaving my friend Solomon. On the computer screen, a green cursor blinked in a password field. Surely you don't have a way to get around the password. Come on, Luca, just tackle him. He's not that big. Luca pecked out his best guess. Underground secrets. These fucking morons, man. The screen blinked to life. Columns of green numbers glowed on a black background. Okay. Well, I don't know how far this evil corporation thinks they could get. Especially with the fact that their password apparently consists of one anagram that somebody thought was funny. Do excuse my rudeness. How did you just guess that? Oh, it's this absurd password Rollo heard when he was down there before. It's funny how someone arrogant to call themselves the founder used such a basic password. Where they were thinking several moves ahead, not expecting anyone to guess something so simple. Those villain types always end up outsmarting themselves. Solomon's jaw clenched into a half smile. Yes, let's just piss him off enough till he has a tantrum. Yes, let's piss off the founder. Your powers of deduction are as impressive as your luck. I didn't realize it was 24601, you're right. But I guess that means that Jean Valjean is one of Beck's moms, who is a super genius scientist mouse. I accept that. Luca quickly scanned the columns for number 24601. Rollo, I think this should do it.
Bingo bango, doors open. Luca, you never fail to impress.
My nose, yep, I have makeup on my nose. What is that slippery lout even doing down here? We have a friend whose mom is in trouble. We're here to get her out. I see.
Okay, Luca, I think we're close. The next door is marked 13806.
Once again, Luca scrutinized the numbers on the screen. In that moment of distraction, Solomon reached forward and pressed the large red button. Damn it. Maybe this one opens the lock.
Crap, we've got company. Luca must go faster.
1 sec, I can't think with all this noise. He quickly skimmed the screen with his finger. Here it is, 13806, go, go, go.
Curse these fumbling hands. My apologies, Luca.
Don't beat yourself up. I know you were just trying to help. We need heist music. Oh man, no water cups. Rollo! Rollo, are you okay? Rollo, come in! Mr. Kerr approached with a sneer and spoke into his walkie-talkie. You can turn off the alarms. They're trapped. With self-satisfaction, he called into the hallway. That, my dears, is a dead end. And this motherfucker is just an actress, and he's doing this because he wants to be a leading man, but he's kind of old, which makes -10 cents. Nowhere to run. Rollo, where are you? Are you okay?
Yeah, I think we lost him. Making our way back to Nellie's office.
Okay, you two rabble-rousers are coming with us. Nope. Ha! Make a break for it! Did that little shit just kick me? Don't just stand there. After them. Oh, is the old man's knee broken?
Okay, I think that worked.
I'm gonna have to stop doing this. Roxy and Fitz have them on a wild goose chase. I'm having trouble following what just happened. Like I said, it's good to have friends. Rollo, how long do you think Roxy can distract them? How long can Roxy keep someone so pissed off they can't see straight? Let's just say we've got time. Entering Nellie's office now.
Mom!
Oh, honey, what did you do to your hair?
I thought you'd be happy. I finally used the young chemist's lab kit.
You sure have a knack for making me incredibly proud in the most frustrated ways.
We need to get you out of here.
We? Who is your adult friend?
Oh, I'm not an adult. Ever heard of a growth spurt? I had more of a growth spew.
No, that's not possible.
Nellie leaned over to examine his teeth.
Substantial banding on the enamel of the molars consistent with Tempest Liquamine exposure.
Is that what you call that gunk they forced me to drink?
You drank it? Oh no. They told me it was only being tested on plants. Oh, Beck, sweetie, I promise I didn't know.
Mom, what the hell is going on at this place?
I was brought here to work on the discovery of a lifetime. A novel chemical compound was discovered under Beacon Pines in a wellspring they call the Source. They named it Tempest Liquamine. It pulls energy from its surroundings in order to fundamentally alter matter's relationship to time. It was the secret to Valentine's fertilizer. They harvested the source, infusing small amounts of Tempest Liquamine into the product. It worked wonders, drastically accelerating plant growth. Crops would be ready to harvest in a fraction of the time. But it led to complications.
The foul harvest!
Perennial Harvest came in to clean up the mess, to succeed where Valentine failed. But Tempest Liquamine is rebellious.
Rebellious?
You can think of it as a manifestation of change itself. It's volatile by its very nature.
So the more you try to force it to do a specific thing,
the more it resists, yes.
I can relate to that.
My role is to finish the work of my predecessor, Dr. Prescott, harnessing Tempest Liquamine to reliably manipulate an organism's age. Just imagine how many people we could feed. Mr. Kerr was very insistent that we achieve a successful result before today's festival.
But you didn't, right? Nellie sighed.
You know how much I love a good puzzle. I poured myself into the problem. It wasn't long until I discovered oddities in Dr. Prescott's notes.
Oddities?
They contained obvious errors, mistakes that someone of his reputation would never make. So I fixed them, and...
And now I get to replace my entire wardrobe.
I really am truly sorry.
Those clothes were all hand-me-downs anyway. Sounds like Dr. Prescott figured it out, got cold feet, and intentionally sabotaged his own work.
I had considered that possibility. I've sent a letter asking him to clarify his thinking.
Mom, Dr. Prescott's dead. Kerr had him killed.
What?
I overheard them talking about it on the radio. That's why we gotta get you out of here.
I just...
Like, now.
Wait, the vial! I finally solved the chemical equation allowing direct control of aging. Mr. Kerr picked it up just before you came.
All the more reason we gotta hightail it. Luca, we've got Dr. Modeville. Are you talking like an opposites attract sort of social thing or a chemistry thing? Because it's not a symbiotic relationship between organisms. It's basically magic goo. Heading your way now. Roger that. Be careful. Alright, everything's on track. And what is your plan for escape?
We'll go over everything when they get here. In the meantime, maybe we can dig up some more info.
Punch him in the face. I'm really sorry you got dragged into this mess, Solomon. You needn't worry about me.
Well, I feel bad either way. We're gonna get you out of this, I promise. With a subtle quivering lip, a smile crawled across Solomon's face.
But first, I'm gonna mess up your shitty office.
Not really, because I don't think it's sentient, and I also don't think they melded it with anything. It seems to be...
I think they're using that as an analogy of like, hey, it's like a kid. But also, I've seen no evidence of sentience or anything similar. Luca tugged on each of the cabinets. Dang, this must be the good stuff. They're all locked. Perhaps he's not as careless as you suspected. Gotta keep that ego intact, bruh. Hi, Pumpkin Sarge, I love you. Looks like the founder was helping Kerr plan the festival. Why would such a secretive leader be obsessed with a party? Only time will tell. Luca held his hand up to the ashtray. Still warm. He must have been in here recently. Hey, Solomon, why do you smell like expensive Cuban cigar smoke? I don't know. It's a mystery. Malice 80 proof whiskey. A hard drink for a hard man. Wow, even his alcohol is arrogant.
Oh, for God's sake.
Solomon muttered inaudibly. I should just smother you right now. What's that? I said, I shouldn't bother you right now. Don't be silly, you're no bother at all. Look at the picture of the darts in it, please. Let's see what else this bad boy has on it. Security system, time card logs, payroll. You know, for being so evil, this guy sure is boring. Solomon once again muttered under his breath. Just you wait. Huh? Oh, nothing. If this child is drinking hard whiskey, shouldn't he be absolutely shit-faced? They heard the trampling of frantic footsteps from the hallway.
Lock it, lock it, lock it!
Locked. That was close. When we left Nellie's office, it was swarming with clipboards. We barely got away. Did they follow you? Rolo, before we start tossing blame around, is it possible someone ordered a pizza? Oh, I have pizza. We'd love to hear your thoughts. Definitely not pizza. What now? Don't look at me, I'm officially retiring from the heisting business. We're so sorry for the inconvenience. We just have a few quick questions. Just let me think. Can someone watch the door? Of course. Everyone else huddle up. Well, that'll work well. Oops. I think this little caper has gone on long enough. Solomon, no! Hush now, child. The adults are speaking. Dr. Modeville, a brief reintroduction is in order. We've never met in person, but we have corresponded. You see, it was I who hired you. Solomon, the pathetic orphan child, being raised in the lap of luxury, but sure. The powerful and enigmatic founder, Sharper, the fallen progenitor who created this town. Perennial harvest, Valentine fertilizer, all connected by a single thread. Yours truly. But that's... Her eyes searched the floor in thought. Solomon watched eagerly, waiting for the flicker of epiphany. With a sickened look, she peered into his soul. Ha! Yes, now you've got it.
Tempest liquamine. You discovered how to reverse the process.
Solomon clapped with genuine delight. Very good, Dr. Modeville. Very good. Though the discovery wasn't intentional. Solomon glanced down, examining his youthful form. And the effects went a little too far for my taste.
That's why you needed me to finish Dr. Prescott's work.
Which you did, admirably. Mr. Kerr, the vial, please. Kerr presented it with a theatrical twirl of the hand. May I present to you the eighth wonder of the... Before he could finish, Rolo snatched the vial from Kerr's palm. Wow, this stuff sounds pretty valuable. Be careful, you fool. You have no idea what you have in your hand. Actually, we do. You just did a whole evil villain monologue thinking about it. Rolo casually tossed the vial to Luca. Gosh, maybe I'll have a taste. Luca jiggled the vial mockingly. Seize him. Luca, over here. Move another inch and I smash it. She held it tightly behind her back. Solomon sighed, speaking in crisp, measured syllables. You have no plan. I'll smash it, I swear. Fine, risk killing us all. Or, if you're lucky, nothing happens. Then what? We capture you and grant you much less leniency. He pursed his lips with feigned sincerity. But I give you my word. If you hand it over now, none of you will be harmed. A deep uncertainty washed over Beck. You're a smart girl, Beck. But there's no shame in being outwitted by someone smarter than you. We both know there's only one way this ends. She looked to Nelly shakily. With a dispirited nod, Nelly sighed in defeat. Beck slowly approached Solomon.
Girl!
That's a good girl.
Beck, don't do it! We can't trust that jerk!
I'm sorry, he's right. With apprehension, Beck conceded. Solomon pocketed the vial and brushed off his shoulder with a sharp flick. Mr. Kerr, you have allowed yourselves to be humiliated by a group of children. Report to my office tomorrow for a performance review. The blood drained from Kerr's face.
Of course, sir.
But first, you have a speech to make. Trot out there and give me the introduction I deserve. And don't forget to smile.
Yes, sir.
And to think, all of this is thanks to the efforts of Mr. Van Horn.
I don't understand. How is this all because of me?
Ha! I said Mr. Van Horn, silly child. Dr. Walt Van Horn. Your father was always a thorn in my side. I offered him an opportunity to be a part of something great, but the fool was blinded by righteousness. He even broke into my laboratory in an attempt to sabotage my work. Why can't I talk today? Solomon shook his head with gratification. But the universe has a funny way of correcting course. By meddling with a force he didn't understand, Walt showed me its true potential. As fate would have it, Luca, your father's dying act was to grant me eternal life. A muffled applause resonated faintly through the walls. Well, that's my cue. After the festivities and my subsequent ascension, I will return to deal with you all. Until then, I suggest you use this time to reflect on the magnitude of your failure. You three keep post outside the door. Okay, so this very rich man who owned the town was using a crazy thing to make fertilizer, and when it didn't work, he faked his death, turned into a child, created an entirely new shell company to come back to the town, have the town move, have this entire thing ready, led by an actor solely who he could turn back into an adult and take over the town, which he already had control of. Okay. Well, crap. Come on, secret passage. He's a cowardly fuck. There's gotta be one. I can't believe Beck sold us out like that. I'm not sure she had any other choice. So what now? What's the plan? I don't have one. Of course you do. You always have a plan. Rollo. You just need some time. Rollo, it's over. We lost.
Hell no, it's not.
What about the super genius adult? Nelly was staring at the floor, deep in thought. Oh, for sure. I don't know why you just wouldn't bribe people until the, health officials forgot about it, and then maybe rebrand at most.
Sorry, Luca. Give me a minute to calm my mind.
She gave him the hair dye, didn't she? Hey.
I'm sorry, Luca. I did what I had to do.
I know, it's just we were so close. Got a feeling that, eventually, Solomon will get what's coming to him. Time wounds all heals. Well, time seems like less of an issue for him now.
Luca, there's something you should know. After Mr. Kerr locked me in that office, I had nothing but time and curiosity. I poked around a bit, hoping to find a means of escape, but I found something else. A note hidden in a false drawer.
What sort of note?
Dr. Prescott must have sensed his time at Perennial Harvest was growing short, so he left behind a letter with the hope it would be found by his successor. It was a confession of sorts. He left it for me, but its contents... Luca, I think they were meant for you.
Why? What did it say?
It was about an incident with your mother.
Okay, on that exciting note, I'm going to take a quick break to take my dog out. But stay tuned, I'll be back in 5 minutes and we'll talk about his mother. Dun, dun, dun. All right. I just remembered I have this. And a little black cat seems very suited for Halloween. Also, she's like Beck, so. Whew. Let's move her up a bit. Oh, thanks, Sarge. I closed that door, but... Oh, well. It was about an incident with your mother. So we did learn about this in the one of the many stories from yesterday. Sarge, come here. And let me tell you, it's freaking weird. You'll see. Dr. Prescott found her in his lab with a stolen key card. There was an accident. She had been exposed to extreme amounts of Tempus Liquidium. The color dropped from Luca's face. She survived. Dr. Prescott decided to help her recover. He no longer trusted Perennial Harvest, so he kept her whereabouts a secret. Over time, your mother led him to reconsider the purpose of scientific discovery. Science is often at the vanguard of change, but that doesn't always mean it's right. He realized that no one should have control over something as powerful as time itself. I now believe that's why he began to intentionally sabotage his own work. And it cost him his life. That's a reasonable conclusion. Luca was overwhelmed with emotion. But if she's alive, where has she been? Where is she now? A sudden explosion sounded from the hall. Chapter 8. Comeuppance. Ears still ringing, Gran picked herself up off the ground. Through the dust and smoke, she looked over to see Mrs. Fratelli helping Hiram Tolliver to his feet. She'd had to beg, borrow, and steal to acquire those explosives. How many nights had she spent visualizing how she'd use them to make things right? And now, her one shot at destroying the source, the damned hole that swallowed so much of her life, was gone. Traded for this jagged hole in a wall and a foolhardy shot at rescuing Rolo. With Fratelli and Tolliver at her side, she stepped through. It was a strange feeling. The last time she'd stalked this maze of hallways, it was in a different body. They quickly rounded a corner to find a group of clipboards guarding a door. Something worth guarding is probably something worth seeing. She leapt forward, brandishing her cane. If her last chance at vengeance for things lost was truly gone, she would just have to fight to keep what she still had. Gran, what are you doing here? Luca, what are you doing here? We're here to save Nelly. We're here to save Rolo. Hey, Miss Lucas Gran. That's awful nice of you, but I'm fine. Oh, God, what did they... Gran, there's no time to explain. We have to go now. Come on, everyone. We've got a party to crash. They made their way out from deep within Perennial Harvest, just as Solomon finished up his speech. Good, I don't want to do it again. Thankfully, we can dispense with the formalities from here on out. Solomon pulled a glass vial from his pocket. We gotta stop him! In one smooth motion, he downed its contents. Again, this is not like the worst thing in the world. He's an adult, okay, you can still kill him. Triumphant smile grew across Solomon's lips. No! Well, I guess that's it. We lost. I wouldn't be so sure about that. With a mischievous look, Beck elbowed Luca. Remember when I had the vial behind my back? Might have tweaked his wonder potion with a little... Junk change malice. Malice. This is probably gonna kill him, isn't it? I'm fine with that. Malice? The whiskey from his office? Yep. Dude had an unfinished glass on his desk. Figured his grow juice because you could use a little hair to the dog. You can all call me Sharper Valentine. His body and face began to contort and expand as he disappeared into a belching green mist. And then he turned into a whiskey bottle at the end. Now that's what I call 80 poof whiskey. Inky. I mean, it's fine if she stays in here, just loud.
I thought you were just going out now.
No, I did already.
Oh, okay.
Damn, dude. The crowd gazed in stunned silence at the now empty stage. The quiet was broken when William Kerr sprinted off stage and into the distance. He was never seen around Beacon Pines, or anywhere else for that matter, again. Watching the silhouette of Kerr disappear over the horizon, Luca began to laugh. First a low chuckle that became uncontrolled, heaving laughter. Through his tears, he was vaguely aware that the crowd had begun to laugh with him as well. The end. That was unexpected. Perhaps a bit of an absurd ending for my taste, but who am I to say? I'm only writing the damn thing. Okay. With a little... let's try junk. Can't wait to see the look on his face when he realizes he drank his own cigar ash. How did ashes get into the vial? It's pretty easy to mess with the vial when it was behind my back. Oh, that's sneaky. Well, it's a bad habit anyway. Pa always says bad habits are like 50-yard field goals. Huh? Hard to kick. You all can call me Sharper Valentine. His body and face began to contort. Maybe he'll get lung cancer. And then he turned into a pillar of ashes and died. Okay, I'm sure the right one is changed and that it's going to be hair dye or something, but I enjoy the exploding. Well, that's one way to kick a bad habit. As the last of the crowd of what once was Sharper Valentine wafted into the air, the crowd began to disperse, still numb from what they had observed. Sharper Valentine was gone for good. His end would be a new beginning for Beacon Pines, a new chance to let go of the things they had lost and grab a hold of a new future. The end. Well, I'd be lying if I said that wasn't a bit gratifying. That feels to you like a good note to end on. I won't stand in your way. This doesn't make sense unless you put money in it. Like pocket change? Your unlucky penny! Copper. Good. Yeah, I plopped it in the vial when no one was looking. What's it going to do? No idea! That's the beauty of science. Now, we observe. Yeah, it's Sharper Valentine, blah 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 blah. I hope he stays a child and everyone can just laugh at him. Oh god, he turned into a baby. Holy crap, he's a baby? Yeah, but he's still sharper. Right? What he was no longer matters. This is an innocent child. I apologize for all the harm my father has caused you. Eris awkwardly cradled the squirming child. She looked to her brother, her voice shaking with uncertainty. Augustus, what do we... We do what Valentines always do. What must be done. I'll hurry home and prepare crib for father. Sharper. Right? This child is absolutely gonna do some demon shit. That would be a great help. Thank you. She looked back down at the infant with equal parts kindness and terror in her eyes. With a shake of her head, Eris addressed the crowd with a stern scowl. Okay, everyone. The show is over. You may leave now. Epilogue. Beacon Pines' coldest summer on record came and went without much fanfare. Folks shared what they had and none were left wanting. The new school year was ushered in by the falling leaves of autumn. After everything Luca, Rollo, and Beck had been through, middle school was bearable. The chill of winter didn't seem to bother people much. They kindled a hope for a better future in their hearts. When spring arrived, farmers planted their crops with a sense of joy and optimism. And as the dawn of the first day of summer came again, its light slowly spread through the shallow valley. It crept over the town square, across the river, past the neglected welcome sign, and came to rest on a young boy, sleeping at dawn. His mind at peace, knowing he's here for a reason. He has a new shirt! Roller, are you up yet? Roger that. It's a beautiful day at Mission Control. You gonna swing by? Be there in a minute. I need to explain some lore things if this game doesn't. But I hope it will at least a bit. Over time, Eleanor... Yeah, okay, so his grandma's his mom, is what I'm trying to say. And she just lived with him, pretending to be his grandma and that his mom had abandoned him. And being a lot more distant than his mother was. Which I think is kind of child abuse, but at least she explained that. Out of the closet and into storage. Okay. Eleanor had moved back into her bedroom, and now that she wasn't sneaking out late, she even slept there most nights. This does still mean that he would become parentless at quite a young age, though, right? Assuming the aging thing actually ages every part of you, I guess? I don't know. But also, do they not know that the town moved? Because A, it did. B, his freaking... There was a really emotional part where he realized that the grave he talked to was not his dad. They didn't exhume the body or anything. It's just nothing. Mom, I'm ready to go now. You go on without me, I'll meet you there. Got a batch of jam to finish jarring. It's funny. I only started making jam as a way to send messages without anyone noticing. But now I enjoy it. Still want to find those drugs. Oh, I guess they do know. They moved the giant tree, which seemed excessive to me. Here, you and Rolo have big plans for that little treehouse. Yeah, it started getting crowded after we evoked the max capacity one Rolo, one Luca rule, so we decided to expand. But at least we've got some help with that. How's the internship at Nellie and Ilona's shop going? It's been great. Hoping it helps me get into the School of Agriculture up at State. Also, Nellie said she'd write a letter of recommendation, which would be huge. Just can't help but worry about leaving Rolo. He's grown up so fast, but he's still my little brother. Yeah, he had a heck of a growth spurt. I don't just mean grown, literally. This morning he was up and finished his chores before I even had breakfast. Well, some of that might be his excitement about the treehouse renovations. Don't tell him this, because it'll go to his head, but I'm really proud of that little punk. I'm sure he feels the same way, but he's just too dang proud to tell you. I know. Hey Gus, how's the tree planting going? Couldn't be better. So grateful to Ilona and Nellie for letting me help. Just wasn't built to be a mayor. Too much bureaucracy. Gus, we finished cleaning up the sidewalks. What's next? When perennial harvest collapsed, most of the clipboards skipped town. But some stuck around and dedicated themselves to making things right. What are they? Anyone with a knack for art can help paint the new offices. You can count on us. Well, it looks like you really found your calling. I never really felt comfortable telling people what to do. Now this right here? This is something I can be proud of. Are we just gonna ignore all the dystopian shit, I guess? Slow and Dirty Harvest. I see you decided on a name. Yep, we had to clear out all the old stuff before putting on the final touch. Slow and Dirty Harvest is now official. I like it. It was actually Nellie's idea. There's still a lot of work to do, and the name serves as a reminder. Just because progress is important doesn't mean change should happen fast. In fact, I've learned that the more you care about something, the more important it is to take things slow. Our motto is, go slow and fix things. Amen to that! Can I kick the drugstore guy? No! You can shut my door if it's easier.
It's up to you.
I had it shut, he just opened it.
Okay.
Yo, you got any fish now? Luca, get this. I managed to reel in an actual fish this morning. Seriously? It's okay. Don't worry about it. Yeah, an honest-to-goodness flip-flop-and-swim swam and fish. I don't think I've ever caught an actual fish here. Been at least 7 years since I've caught one. I'd say it's a good omen. What'd you do with the fish? Oh, I released it back into the pond. Hoping to catch it again tomorrow. A little higher.
Yep.
A little lower.
Yep.
Little higher.
Yep.
I'm telling you, the angle isn't the issue. We need more power to the radio. Luca, there you are. So I guess him being an adult is just now a puberty thing? Okay. Would you tell him it's not the angle? Hey, I'm not in charge of antenna redesign. Fine. Iggy, just don't do anything drastic until we get back. Who, me? Tish, you're in charge while I'm gone.
Yep.
It'll be fine, right? It'll be fine. If we really want mission control to turn into something bigger and better, we have to loosen our grip a bit. You're right. Lead the way. Okay, but what if we go this way and go to the old fake town? Or the old real town? Is it still in endless winter? Young Mr. Van Horn. How's little Solomon, Sharper doing? Young Sharper seems to enjoy nature more than I. So we do a lot of strolling these days. This is so fucked up. Has he, attempted to crawl out of his crib and plot world domination? Yeah. Thankfully, no. I spoke at length with Dr. Modeville, and she feels that Sharper's infant mind was not developed enough to retain his previous memories. For all intents and purposes, the child is unmolded clay. Let's hope he's a little nicer the second time around. That is the objective, yes. But really, all I can do is try and hope. Two activities I am endeavoring to find less distasteful. Well, I think you're doing a great job, and the whole town is ready to help out however we can. Can't wait to teach him to throw a baseball. Eris did her best to ignore the tears welling in her eyes. That would be acceptable. This is so did they not see how fucking weird this is? I'm so sorry. Luca, you want a biscotti? Biscotto. On the house. I don't really have time. Zariel, you gotta come and see this. I finally did it. I pulled the perfect espresso. Aw, Lumi. If I didn't know better, I would think you're proud of something. Huh. As if. No. It's too late. You are now officially a person that cares. He looked to his friends with a thankful smile. After everything that could have gone wrong, everything that did go wrong, we made it. The end. Closing her eyes, Miss Hatch took a deep, relaxing breath. Oh, hello, Luca. How are you? Really good, actually. That's wonderful. Did I miss anything? I think you're pretty much up to speed. What's today's news that needs knowing? I'll give you tomorrow's headline today. Our old friend Patrick C. Montesquieu, aka William Kerr, just performed a stirring rendition of the Iceman Cometh at the State Correctional Facility. I hear there wasn't a dry eye in the house. Well, I guess he has plenty of time to work on his craft. At least somebody was punished. Glad you swung by. More follow-up questions for your story? Nope. I got everything I need. Thanks again for that. I sent a draft of the story to a reporter in Capital City, and they offered me an internship. Of course they did. You're an amazing reporter. I don't know about all that.
story about a phony corporation that picked up an entire town of people and moved them to cover up a massive illegal mineshaft full of incredibly hazardous chemicals sort of writes itself. If you think about it. Don't forget us when you become a fancy big city reporter. Capital City isn't that far away. Gonna have to come back from time to time to check in and see what sort of new trouble you've gotten yourself into. Sorry to disappoint, but my adventuring days are over. We both know that's not true. What makes you say that? Call it a reporter's intuition. Why are these guys not arrested? Mrs. Fratelli glowed with a carefree smile. Is that your suitcase? That is 2 weeks of unencumbered tranquility. Excuse me, would you be so kind as to take my order? 2 weeks of sand, margaritas, and forgotten obligations. Excuse me, I'd love to place an order. Mrs. Fratelli sighed with zen-like calm. Just as soon as the lunch rush ends. I'll be a feather on the wind. You're going on vacation? For the first time in years. And I've got you and your mom to thank. Why's that? She didn't tell you yet. You two are gonna fill in for me at the diner while I'm gone. Just like old times. It's fine. I'll wait. Wait, did they deface his statue? And if they did, can I read it? They just left it there? Really? Hey, look. Humans. Over the school year, Kato and Bert had become close friends. But did you know that when they covered up the source, they found a new species of fungus? Yep, and they're studying it in the new labs. Did you know that Beacon Pines is now the smallest town in the county? Yep, close to the population before perennial harvest moved in. It typically went on like this for quite some time. I can't believe it's over. Yeah, the town's really starting to turn a new leaf. The town? I was talking about Hank Atomic. I just finished the last issue. How was it? Great as always. Hank finally returned to Earth. But I just feel weird now. Weird can be cool. Just means you're ready for something new. Any suggestions? You could ask Miss Hatch about what she's always reading. She seems to really enjoy it. Huh. Maybe I'll do that. Luca peeked over Piper's shoulder. Laid stealthily inside a large volume of mathematics was the first issue of Hank Atomic. Piper, are you reading Hank Atomic? Do you mind not telling anyone? Kinda got a reputation to uphold. Oh, it's nothing to be ashamed of. Just about every kid in town reads Hank Atomic, all five of them. Honestly, I'm excited for you. What I'd give to start over fresh. To experience it again for the first time. I guess that's the downside of finishing something nice. At least now I can enjoy it again through you. Promise to tell me about it as you go? Sure thing. Alright, game. I get the meta. Okay, last time I have to do this voice. Hey, Mr. Nuncreed. I'm gonna go see my dad in a bit. Did you want to come with?
Even after everything I did, you'd still...
Mr. Nuncreed shook his head.
You really are your father's son, aren't you? I don't think I'm ready for that yet.
Well, you're always invited. I'd bet he'd love to hear from you.
I'll visit Walt in my own time. You run along now.
Maybe it's because they're kids. I would not be this fucking forgiving. I'm so sorry. With perennial harvests gone, the transportation tubes were left unused.
Come one, come all. No one's too big, no one's too small for Jeff's wild ride.
Well, maybe not completely unused.
One piece of candy for the ride of your life. Who's next?
Me, 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 me. I hope they cleared out all the toxic waste. Guess what? Yesterday I saw a dinosaur's Tidius. And that's good. It's great! I haven't spotted one of those in years! At this rate, Beacon Pines is going to become the bug capital of the county. What if I want to keep in, actually? Oh, come on.
kill when we have any fun going to the nuclear waste factory. See how it is. Can I break into this house? The Valentine Mansion loomed over every other building in town, both figuratively and literally. I have news I think you'll enjoy. This morning I unpacked my last box. You're officially moved in! It's just a box. Let's not blow this out of proportion. It sounds an awful lot like putting down roots! Guess I decided this place is root-worthy. You're gonna be stuck with me for the foreseeable future. I do have to warn you, most years aren't going to be as interesting as this one. I think I'll manage. Ready? Before we go, there's a bit of a surprise. My mom's prepared this tree especially for you. They didn't have to do that. It wasn't just them. Just about the whole town pitched in. We all owe you. Should do okay in the cold of old Beacon Pines. And thrive as things warm up. That's perfect. I'm not ready. I hate endings. But I know there's nowhere else to go, so... Ah, you got it. Now that's a good-looking tree. Being a special occasion and whatnot, this rides on the house. You're gonna want to hang tight to that little tree. Wait, who the fuck was that guy who was like, I'm the watcher, I just kind of wander around here and all that? What happened to him? I think this is it. The end I've been waiting for. Honestly, I'd begun to lose hope of ever finding it. But then you came along. I don't know exactly how to thank you. It's hard to explain how much this means to me. It's funny, now that our time together is finally ending, I'm at a loss for words. Let's just watch the end together. Done. Good little tree. Best little tree! Thank you, children. This means a lot. Yeah, thanks for everything. Shucks, I only did what any super awesome best buddy would have done. We should probably give you some time alone now. You good? Yeah, I am. It's been a wild year. How are you feeling? Everyone keeps asking me that. I'm fine, really. Pa always says the only thing fitter than a fiddle is a cello. I feel like a dang cello. Well, if you ever stop feeling like a cello, I'm here for you. I know. You don't even have to say it. You two make an awesome pair. Excuse me? We're a trio now. Yep. Thanks. There's just one thing missing now that you're a part of our group. Missing? Let me tell you a little story about a man named Hank Atomic. Oh god. I won't be long. We'll be waiting for you back at the phone booth. I've found the perfect way to start our summer. You've got some good friends. I'm so proud of you. Your father would be so proud.
I know. Mom, can I ask you a question? Do you ever dream about Dad?
Not a night goes by that I don't.
Are you ever afraid that you're going to forget him?
Forget what he looked like? Forget his voice?
No, because so much of him lives on in you.
He loved that old tree. But I know he would have loved this one more. Because his two favorite people planted it. I'll give you two a moment.
Hey, Dad. Dr. Medva says that over the next few years, this place should warm up. So you won't have to be so cold for much longer.
I think I finally understand why you left that night. There were things you believed in. Big things. Those beliefs were the things that made you, you. If you wouldn't have stood up to Sharper, stood up for what you believed in, you wouldn't have been the same person anymore.
You had to go, but that didn't mean you loved us any less. I might not visit you as much as they used to. I know you understand.
This is painful. My poor heart.
Well?
Ow, my poor heart.
Happy Halloween. Now I'm sad. I actually really do... What is social? Oh, no.
No. Help, how do I get out of this?
I was trying to figure out how... Nope. Good God, no. I wanted to figure out what language this was based in, if any. But... Yeah, I guess we're done. That's weird. It's a weird feeling. Very weird feeling indeed. But kind of nice? I guess that's what, you know, you're supposed to feel or whatever. Right? That's how this works. Sad that it's over. Happy you did. But yeah, I won't keep you all any longer. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you have a wonderful Halloween. And I'm sure I will speak to you all soon with... I don't know, this game's gonna be a little hard to top. We'll see. Until then, thank you so much for watching, and I will see you on the flip side.